The decision today to bar all spectators from attending Olympic events in Tokyo comes just 2 weeks before the Games are set to begin. Organizers once hoped the Games would be a global showcase for Japan. But there has been widespread opposition within the country to hosting them during the pandemic. Only 15% of Japan's population is fully vaccinated. And there is concern that cases are rising again this summer. More than $20 billion have already been committed to pulling off these Olympics. For a look at all of this, I'm joined by Christine Brennan, a sports columnist for USA Today. She will be going to Tokyo to cover her 19th Olympics. And Sheila Smith, a senior fellow for Asia Pacific Studies at the Council on Foreign Relations, and she has written extensively about Japan. It's so good to have both of you with us. Thank you for joining us. Christine, I'm going to start with you. Why the organizers' decision today to say not only foreign tourists can come to sit and watch these Olympics, but no one, not even Japanese residents?
Judy, they have declared a state of emergency that will run through the entire Olympic Games. This is exactly what the International Olympic Committee was not planning when it postponed the Games last March during the height of as the pandemic was starting. But here we are. And so you've got a state of emergency, you've got COVID cases rising in Tokyo and the surrounding area, and you've got basically, what, 15 to 20% of Japanese residents completely fully vaccinated. And it was a very slow process to vaccinate the population in Japan. They were very slow off the mark. So now you've got this situation where you just can't trust it. You just can't put people in those venues. And even as the athletes of the world show up, there will be some who are not vaccinated. We don't know how many, but certainly there will be unvaccinated athletes coming into Japan, and the risk is too great. And it truly is a shame because this is the greatest regularly scheduled peacetime gathering of the world. The Olympic Games are the youth of the world coming together for good, for sport. And of course, this is a gathering that will have no gathering because the athletes can't even mix. And you can't have those scenes in the square with television sets and everyone together in a glorious celebration. It's a very, very unfortunate.
And Sheila, we are reading that the Japanese public didn't want the Games to go forward. Why did the Japanese government say yes? The Games will go forward despite all these restrictions. And what kind of pressure were they under from the International Olympic Committee?
So thank you, Judy. I think it's really been hard for Prime Minister Suga and his cabinet to try to balance both the COVID pandemic and the management of that pandemic with the real investment, both in financial terms, but also in expectations for these Olympics. The Japanese people largely love the Olympic Games and were delighted when Tokyo was selected to host them. But as the pandemic became more severe and as the consequences of that pandemic for this year's Games became more acute, not only in Japan, but around the world, I think the Japanese public has really turned sour on the idea that they should be hosting them. As you pointed out in your opening piece, about 85% of the Japanese public feel that they should be postponed once again or canceled altogether. I think what's at stake is obviously a lot of government investment. These Olympic Games for cities, for countries, are not inexpensive endeavors. But there's also the idea that they could showcase Japan to the world, to show a renewed Japan, a technologically sophisticated Japan, and Japanese culture to the world.
Christine, bringing it back to the International Olympic Committee, they've been pushing very hard for these Games to go forward. Why?
So much money. It's all about the money. It's all about billions of dollars. Sponsorship. It's about the Olympic committees that need that money as well. Basically, a Summer Olympics or a Winter Olympics, which will happen in Beijing in 6 months, it funds everything. And there's also, in addition to that, obviously that's a very big reason, just the financial reason, and that's why it's going to look like a TV show, and they almost don't, they care about not having fans, but not really. They want the show to go on, the television show to go on. It could be in a soundstage, really. But also, I think you've got the hubris of the International Olympic Committee, and that is not breaking news. We are talking about people who, in some cases, are royalty in Europe, or they think they're royalty. They stay at the finest hotels, and they have the biggest per diems and the great meals, and they're the ones, the lords of the rings, that run the Olympics. And they're not going to have anything but their Olympic Games. And I'm wondering for the future, if we look back at this time, maybe 20, 30 years from now, if the Olympics really struggle, we may look at this as this, again, this confidence bordering on hubris, the sense that we will do this no matter what, and come what may. And we'll see, of course, what comes what may over the next month or so.
And Sheila, you were starting to talk about what's at stake for the Japanese, for the organizers, for the country. It's their reputation, and they have to be worried about safety.
Absolutely, Judy. I think the government is on tenterhooks here. It's important to point out that the numbers of COVID-19 cases in Japan are still far less than they are here in the United States or in India, for example. But nonetheless, the Japanese people are very worried that this is going to be some kind of super spreader event that the government will not be able to manage. And of course, the stake for Prime Minister Suga and his political party are also very high. There's a lower house election scheduled for October, and getting to the other side of these games safely is going to be very, very important for his political future.
Christine, I want to come back to something you said in your first answer about how different this is going to be for the athletes themselves. What is going to be different? As we mentioned, you've covered, 18 of these Olympic Games before, but what will be different for them?
There's no ability to go out on the town with family or friends after their events or during their events. There's no mingling with the other athletes. The joy of a Canadian being able to sit next to an Indian who's sitting next to an Australian, who's sitting next to a German athletes, all different sports, having lunch or dinner. That can't happen. They cannot sit in the dining hall and enjoy that social time. And when you talk to athletes, as you and I have, Judy, over the years, Olympians from the past, they talk about that, the deep friendships that they made, again, in the village. Can't happen, because you cannot have the risk, COVID, of course, is part of it, but also the contact tracing. You know, someone goes and does that, and then there's, of course, the tracing, the apps. We'll all have them. They'll be watching us, our every move. And then you go back to your dorm, your Olympic Village hallway, and you contact trace your roommates right out of their event. It sounds like that could be dramatic and maybe won't happen. I certainly hope it doesn't happen, Judy, but it could. And that's why it's going to be a very austere and Spartan Olympic Games, where these athletes compete and then they go home. None of the celebration, the joie de vivre that we're so used to at an Olympic Games.
And just quickly, Christine, the opening ceremony, the closing ceremony, they're still going to have that?
They are. There will be no fans. As we understand it, the athletes may come in. Again, they've got to keep them apart from other countries, which is unusual. Come in, walk around the track, have a wave to empty seats, and then walk right back out and get them back safely to their dorm rooms. Again, a TV show more than anything else.
Christine Brennan, Sheila Smith, the games begin in just a little more than 2 weeks. Thank you both very much.
Thank you, Judy.